Okay, so children are notoriously bad at inhibitory control, and this is important in the moment to stop them from doing embarrassing or mean or unhealthy things or even dangerous things. And it's important in the longer term as well. So inhibitory control in childhood predicts all kinds of important life outcomes years and even decades later, including academic performance, social competence, health, wealth, and criminality. So as a result, there's a lot of interest in attempts to intervene to improve inhibitory control in children and executive function more generally. And many of those attempts have yielded some success, but with a number of caveats. And the ones that I'll focus on today are first, that these attempts have not been reliably successful in the domain of inhibitory control. And that's what I'll focus on in the first part of my talk. Second, relatively little is known about potential interventions in the domain of self-directed executive function, where it's not just people doing something that we're telling them to do, but it's where people determine goals for themselves and how to reach them on their own. And that, I'll talk about that in the second part of my talk. And at the end, I'll consider briefly the idea of there being potential costs to improving executive function. So we may not always want to intervene. There may be trade-offs to doing so. Okay? But I'll start first with this question of inhibitory control. Why are children so bad at inhibitory control? We've developed a framework for understanding this, integrating two different lines of research. The first focuses on an underappreciated aspect of how children develop. And the second focuses on an underappreciated aspect of how we inhibit prepotent responses as adults. Okay? The aspect of how children develop focuses on a transition that they show in the dynamics of their control over their behavior, from a reactive form of control, in the moment, on the fly form of control, to a proactive form of control, increasingly anticipatory or planful. So most developmental theories of cognitive control had assumed that proactive control develops from infancy, that even babies show at least rudimentary forms of the kind of proactive control we use as adults. This idea was incorporated into prominent theories of cognitive control, and I also included this assumption in my modeling work of the development of cognitive control. But more recent work suggests that instead, children show this shift across development from a reliance on this reactive, on-the-fly form of control to adding this proactive form or planful form of control. Okay, and there are a number of studies that demonstrate this. I'll just talk through one example from my lab. In this task, children were told that their job was to help Santa to sort toys, and that the ring around the toy would tell them what their job was. So if the ring included these color paint palettes, their job was to sort the toy by color. So in this case, this blue bear should be sorted. This is the correct response by its color. And if the ring was gray shapes, the job was instead to sort the toys by shape. So in this case, the correct response for sorting this car would be to press that button. Okay? So that was the task that children were given. And we manipulated the extent to which they could prepare in advance for this task in terms of the timing of the cue and the stimulus information. So in one condition, the cue and the stimulus were presented simultaneously. So there was a fixation cross, no information came up, and then at the same time, the stimulus to be sorted came up and showed up along with the cue information. So there was simply no way to prepare in advance for that stimulus appearing, or for what the task was. In a second condition, we made advanced preparation possible by presenting the cue information in advance of the stimulus information. So there was a fixation. At this point in time, the cue information showed up, and then the stimulus appeared. So here, the child could begin to prepare. Color, color, color. That's my job on this trial. In a final condition, we again made advanced preparation possible by providing the cue information in advance of the stimulus information, but we tried to encourage it by making reactive control more difficult by removing the cue information once the stimulus appeared. So there's fixation, cue information appears, stimulus appears, and now cue information is gone. So it's more difficult for children to be reactive and just at this point in time say, oh, what am I supposed to be doing? That information is now gone. So we're not only making proactive control possible, but trying to encourage them to engage in it. And what we found, we tested 5 and 10-year-olds with this paradigm. We found that 10-year-olds were proactive whenever it was possible for them to be, whereas 5-year-olds were proactive only when we encouraged them to be. And we saw this in both reaction time measures and ERP measures. This is showing the reaction time measures, where the 10-year-olds are faster, indicating that they were prepared, more prepared and ready to respond when the stimulus appeared. They were faster in both the proactive possible condition and proactive encouraged condition relative to when it was simply not possible for them to prepare in advance. Whereas the 5-year-olds showed a distinct pattern. They were faster when we encouraged proactive control by making reactive control more difficult, by taking away that cue information once the stimulus showed up. But they looked identical when it was possible but not encouraged for them to be proactive, and when it was simply impossible for them to prepare in advance. They were just as slow across those two conditions, okay? And we saw a complementary pattern of results in an ERP measure. Here we're looking at the Q-locked posterior positivity as an index of advanced preparation, where higher suggests greater preparation. Again, 10-year-olds prepare whenever they can. So in both the proactive possible and proactive encouraged condition, they show this advanced preparation relative to when it's simply not possible. 5-year-olds, in contrast, again, only show the sign of preparing in advance when we've encouraged them to prepare in advance by making reactive control more difficult. When it's possible but not encouraged for them to prepare, they look just like it's completely impossible to plan in advance. Okay? So what does this have to do with inhibitory control? That's the second piece of the foundation for this theory, is that how we inhibit as adults relies fundamentally on a proactive process. In particular, mature response inhibition relies upon proactive processes. And the context for this is that many signatures of response inhibition in adults, from fMRI measures, ERP measures, and behavioral studies, have all been interpreted in terms of stopping per se, that the difficult thing, the thing that activates prefrontal cortex, the thing that generates these ERP signatures, is this process of stopping when you're in the midst of doing something, that that's what inhibitory control is all about. But more recent work suggests that instead, all of those signatures that were interpreted as being about stopping are instead about proactive monitoring of the environment for cues that signal that you might want to update what you're doing. That might be stopping. It might be doing something else. It's not specific to stopping, but it's needed for stopping. So that you're monitoring for a signal that suggests that you might want to change your behavior. So to give you a flavor of what I'm talking about here, I'll have you do the stop signal task, okay, to get a sense of what this component is that I'm talking about. So this is a quintessential response inhibition task that we think also taps proactive monitoring. So what I'd like you to do is do this task by raising your left hand if you see a left-pointing triangle on the screen. Raise your right hand if you see a right-pointing triangle. I'd like you to respond as quickly as possible and try not to respond if you hear a tone. And do I have sound on this so they should hear the tone? Yes, okay, so ready? Okay, good job. So what I want you to take from that is you may sense, so it's a quintessential response inhibition task because you need to override this planned or an ongoing motor response. And often you're doing that motor response on most of the trials in this task. And the stopping of that motor response is what's thought to be the effortful prefrontal component of the task that taps, in particular, the right ventrolateral prefrontal cortex. But our argument is that this task may also tap this proactive monitoring process. You may have sensed that you're proactively monitoring for the tone that might come up to say that you need to stop. You might be actively maintaining the tone, waiting for it, or actively maintaining the goal that you might need to stop. You're not simply going and stopping. There's this other process involved, and that's what we think is key. So to test that idea, we had subjects do a task very much like the one you just did, where in the stopping version, they're doing this and then they're told, try not to respond if you hear a tone. That's the classic stop version. But critically, we gave them another condition where all of these things were the same, but now they were told that what they should do if they hear a tone is finish what they're doing and go again. Okay? And the logic was that if what really matters for all these different brain and behavioral signatures is stopping specifically, stopping an ongoing action, you should see all those signatures for this condition where you're stopping, but not for this condition where you're going and then going again. Whereas if what's critical is this proactive monitoring, watching for these tones that signal you need to do something different, you should see those signatures for both of these conditions where you're monitoring for that tone to update your action. Okay, and that's what we found. Across fMRI, ERP, pupil metric, and behavioral measures, the evidence was consistent with this idea that these signatures reflect proactive monitoring of the environment for relevant cues, not stopping per se. And I'll just give one example. Here, this is the fMRI version of the task, where this is showing activation during the stop version of the task in red, and activation during the double go version of the task in blue, with overlap shown in purple. And what you can see is that you get this large region of right ventrolateral prefrontal cortex that's typically activated for stop signal tasks, but it's completely overlapping across these two tasks, one in which you're actually stopping, one in which you're not stopping at all, but have similar monitoring demands. Okay. So what does this mean for developing inhibitory control? Putting these two pieces together. The first part is that children show this transition. I've focused here on this 5 to 6 year window where they're really transitioning. They can use proactive control if you encourage them, but they're not so inclined to do so. Earlier than that, in other work, we've shown that they tend to use reactive control, and eventually they become more adept at using proactive control. And the second piece is that response inhibition relies critically on this proactive monitoring process. It's not simply about being able to stop yourself once you realize you're doing something inappropriate. There's a proactive monitoring process before you even get to that point that aids the ability to stop in those moments. And so this elaborates that thought to say that children struggle with inhibitory control because it relies on a proactive monitoring process, whereas children engage control more reactively than proactively early in development. Okay. So we've built on this idea to explore the implications for intervening to improve children's inhibitory control. And we've taken two approaches. One is to support reactive control in young children who we think are not capable of proactive control. So in the moment when they're about to do something wrong, supporting them, reminding them of what they're supposed to do. And I won't focus on that today, but I just wanted to flag that as one approach. The other approach we've taken is to try to train proactive monitoring in older children who are capable of engaging proactive control but may not be that skilled at it. And that's what I'll present here. Here we looked at actually 7 to 9 year old children on a stop signal task. And what they ultimately did at test after different forms of training was the stop signal task where they were told, press the banana to feed it to the monkey. But on a subset of trials, after this showed up, the banana would turn brown. And they were told, on those, don't press. Okay, baby monkey doesn't like brown bananas, so don't press. So they're in the midst of reaching, and they have to stop themselves in the middle of that reach. And what we looked at was what would help kids to do better on this task. In one condition, we gave them practice stopping. So they were told, here, press the plane to make it land. And then on the a subset of the trials, they were told, but if the weather gets stormy, don't press the plane, because then it's too dangerous to land. So they got this very relevant experience for what they would be tested on, where they're in the midst of pressing, and they have to stop themselves in the midst of that press. But we tried to minimize the extent to which they needed to proactively monitor for changes in the environment by making this an extremely salient event. So the entire screen turned gray, and there was a loud thunderclap. It's not something they had to pay a lot of close attention to notice. Okay, so that was one training condition. In another condition, we gave them practice proactively monitoring for the relevant information, but we taught them the exact wrong response to that information. So in this case, they were told they should press the banana to feed it to George, but on a subset of the trials, the banana would turn brown, and for those, they should continue their press and then press it again quickly to make it go away. Okay, so this is very much like the double go condition from the fMRI study that I just presented, where we're trying to give them the same common demand that we think is critical for response inhibition of monitoring for these cues that signal that you need to do something different, but we're teaching them exactly the wrong response. They're learning to go and go again instead of learning to stop. And what we found, this shows children's response inhibition. This is plotting their stop signal reaction time. So higher means less efficient inhibitory control. So this is on that test case. We found that compared to a control condition where children were simply exposed to all of these relevant stimuli and changes in the stimuli, practice with motoric stopping did improve children's inhibitory control. So those kids did better when they came to this test measure compared to these controlled children. But it was even more effective for them to receive practice on proactive monitoring. So here, by learning to watch for this relevant stimulus, that actually improved their inhibitory control here, even though what they had learned was this exactly wrong behavior, that when they see this thing happen, they should go and go again. Okay? The analogy that I like to use to drive home how counterintuitive this result might be is, imagine that you're trying to teach a child inhibitory control over hitting other children. Okay? They're hitting other children and you want them to stop. What this training corresponds to is you teach them that they should focus on monitoring the environment for relevant cues that might signal that they should stop. So they might look and see if their friend looks upset or is cowering or some bad reaction. That's what they should learn to watch for. And if they see that, then they should hit their friend twice. Okay? It's that weird, right? They've learned this completely wrong thing, but the idea is that that ultimately helps them when they need to come out and stop, because it's so critical that they first learn that process of watching for these relevant cues. And then they can go from there, even if they've learned the wrong thing to associate with that proactive process. Okay, so efforts so far have not been reliably successful in intervening to improve children's inhibitory control. Our work suggests that this may be because this ability is not just about stopping per se. It instead also reflects this proactive monitoring process for cues in the environment that signal that you might want to stop what you're doing or you might want to do something else. And if we can build on that, we may increase our chances of success at intervening to improve children's inhibitory control. Okay, so I'm going to switch gears a little bit for the second part, where I want to turn to this idea that little is known about self-directed executive functioning, where people have to determine goals and how to reach them on their own. So much of the focus in the intervention work for executive function has focused on tasks where adults or experimenters are telling people exactly what they should do. You know, you should be reading these words, you should be naming these colors, you should be hitting these arrows. They're given all of these instructions. And that's where the interventions have focused, just like with the example I just showed you of the stop signal task, where people are instructed on exactly what to do. And that's clearly relevant, right? There are lots of cases in the world where children need to pay attention to adults and need to do what adults are telling them to do for their safety and for health and so on. But another fundamental aspect of growing up is determining what you want to do for yourself, not just what an adult or an experimenter is telling you, but you've got choices and you can figure out your goals. You want to be able to figure out your goals and figure out how to reach those on your own. And our question in trying to start to explore this question is to ask whether societal changes in how children spend their time could be changing these kinds of developmental trajectories. And in particular, this was motivated by many findings suggesting that childhood, the nature of childhood, is fundamentally changing across societies. So many of us might remember scenes from our childhood, something like this, where there are many kids across different ages playing without any adults in sight. But with changes that are happening today, it seems like our kids and children today may remember scenes from their childhood more something like this, where there are many adults around that are specifically directing them on what to do and so on. And that might be changing the opportunities that children have to practice this kind of self-directed behavior, the self-directed executive functioning of deciding for themselves what they want to do, how they want to achieve those goals, when they want to take those steps to achieve those goals. So that was the question we went in here with this eye ultimately towards potential interventions to ask, is the way that kids are spending their time in these kinds of situations shaping their self-directed executive functioning? So that's a very big, broad question, and we've just taken a small first step to try to get at that. That's what I'll present here, where we took a highly exploratory correlational approach to just ask with 6 to 7 year old children, which we focused on because this is an age where children are spending some time in structured activities and some time in less structured activities, but it's maybe getting increasingly difficult to try to protect that less structured time. And we classified how children spent their time in detail based on parent reports. And we looked at the relationship between how they were spending their time and children's executive functioning as measured on both self-directed tasks and on externally driven lab tasks. Okay, so for the child activities, the parents filled out a detailed time diary of the prior week, half hour by half hour, detailing with as much information as they could provide exactly what the children were doing during those time slices. And then these activities were classified using established criteria for child leisure time, where less structured activities were those that the child largely initiated and directed. And those included activities like free time and play, unguided practice, socializing and parties, and other outings and events. And structured activities were those that were largely externally initiated and directed by others. And they included things like guided lessons and practice, homework and studying, chores, and religious activities. And then activities that were classified as other and weren't looked at included sleep, school, eating, hygiene, and commuting. Okay. So that's the time diary. Then we also asked parents, because that was just one slice, it was a very detailed slice, but it was just 1 week, we also asked parents to report on typical less structured time. So how often does your child play with toys alone, with friends and siblings, how often do they read, et cetera. And they filled out a survey of the past year's structured time. So how many hours per week did your child spend in lessons for music, soccer, art, and so on, the prior fall, winter, et cetera. Okay, and these three distinct measures were highly correlated, and so we combined them into composite measures of children's structured and less structured time. And then we measured their executive function. The task I'll focus on here, we measured their self-directed executive function using a verbal fluency task, where the children were instructed to name as many animals or foods as they could in 1 minute. And people show their best performance on this task if they cluster their responses into subcategories, and that's what's shown here. So a subject might produce a bunch of farm animals, horse, cow, sheep, pig, and then a bunch of pets, and then a bunch of sea animals, and then a bunch of safari animals, something like that. And if they cluster their responses like that, and then they switch between clusters, they move on to a new cluster when their options are dwindling within a cluster. And this task is self-directed in a sense. I mean, subjects are given the overall goal of naming as many animals or foods as they can, but they have a lot of room for deciding how to approach that task. And that's the process that relies on these internal cues. They need to determine when they're going to switch from one category to another and what they're going to switch to. None of that is specified for them by an experimenter. And switching, this kind of switching that we're focusing on is the most executively demanding aspect of this task. It's what shows the longest time course of development. It's what activates prefrontal cortical regions. It's what shows the most sensitivity to damage in frontal patients relative to just trying to name a bunch of animals within a subcategory, for example. So that's why we're focusing on this, the self-directed switching. And what we measure is how often children switch within this task, and we weight those switches by the size of these clusters because we have increasing confidence that kids are truly clustering and switching from one cluster to another. And then we always control for vocabulary and intelligence in these kinds of measures. And the key finding from this project is that the way that children spend their time predicts their self-directed executive functioning in this task. So this is showing how much time children spend in less structured activities, and this shows their self-directed executive functioning as measured by that verbal fluency score. As Martha Farah said about her data yesterday, you know, it's clearly a really scattery scatter plot, but there is signal in that noise. There is this relationship where more time in less structured activities predicts better self-directed executive functioning in the lab task. And this is a robust measure, so it holds across increasingly restricted measures. We have this very broad category where many activities count towards less structured activities, but we can make that increasingly strict, for example, by dropping media and screen time. That counts as a less structured activity given the prior literature that we were building on, but that's kind of a more controversial measure, a more controversial activity to be in here. So we looked at it dropping that measure, and the relationship still holds. It also holds if on top of that you drop activities that might have included more structure, like board games with a group or rule-based games like golf and bowling. And it holds, continues to hold if you on top of that also drop enrichment activities that might have yielded benefits specific to this verbal fluency task, like visiting museums, aquariums, zoos, where you might learn more about these subcategories of animals. Okay. And I guess I'll, also say that that the relationship, so it is robust across these different groupings, and it's also specific. So you don't see relationships between less structured time and externally driven measures of executive function. So when the experimenter is telling kids exactly what to do, it doesn't seem to relate to how they're spending their leisure time. But it's when they have more room to make these decisions for themselves that it seems to make a difference how much less structured time they have. Okay, so little is known about self-directed executive functioning. Our results are consistent with the idea that having less structured time may support development of this kind of self-directed ability, that it could give kids opportunities to set goals for themselves, figure out how to reach them, and so on, and that translates into better performance on this self-directed measure in the lab. But of course, this is a very small first step trying to get at this question. There are many caveats. It's just a correlation, so we don't know about the direction of causality. These are fairly coarse measures and fairly targeted focused measures of how kids spend their time and their self-directed executive functioning. We'd really like to broaden those out and include more ecologically valid sampling. And this is a very limited sample as well. So this is a fairly affluent sample from the Boulder area. And as we heard in the symposium yesterday, we know that SES, poverty, all these things can have an impact on this sort of functioning. So all we know is that within this fairly well-off sample, even within which we saw effects of SES predicting outcomes, at least within the sample, having more time and less structured activities was associated with good self-directed executive functioning. And we're now trying to test all these further possibilities to get at questions of causality, to get at richer measures, to look at broader samples, and so on. Okay, so the last thing, I just want to talk briefly about potential costs. So there are attempts to intervene that have been successful. We're building on that work and trying to take it in additional directions. But are there potential costs? So we can improve executive function, as a large body of work has suggested, but this question is about whether we should. Many people have argued that this may be critical for struggling children. So given, as I said at the outset, that executive function is so important in the moment and for predicting all of these long-term life outcomes, if you have children who are struggling in preschool, it could make potentially make a very big difference to support these abilities and send them off on a different track than they would have been otherwise. So that's the kind of argument that people often make for suggesting that we should be developing these interventions. But people then often go to build on that argument to say, well, if we are finding that this is helping the kids who need it most, why not make it available for all kids so we can all reach our greatest potential? And that may be right, but I think it's important to consider that there may be trade-offs to this kind of attempt to improve executive function or any aspect of cognition. And in particular, that there may be advantages in some situations to low executive functioning. So Sharon Thompson-Schill has made this argument for certain situations where you're trying to just learn the statistical regularities in your environment, whether you're trying to learn the language or whether you're trying to learn social conventions is another example. You may actually be better off, and this may be why kids are better off, kind of turning off your frontal cortex and just letting that information come in and picking up on those regularities rather than having this sort of top-down bias and top-down expectation and top-down interpretation of everything that's coming in, which may make it more difficult to accurately encode that statistical information that's coming in. That's one form of the argument. We've also found in some of our work some trade-offs. And here, this is the last study that I'll talk about. This looks at costs and benefits to the development of proactive control. So on the one hand, what I've emphasized so far is that proactive control, it's good. It makes you more prepared. You're ready in advance, and so when something comes up, you're faster to respond to it. But the flip side of that is that it may be more resource demanding. It relies on this active maintenance, on this effortful maintenance of information before you need it. Okay, so you could be doing other things during that period, but instead you're actively preparing for something that has not yet happened. That may not always be a good thing. And in particular, reactive control may be more adaptive in some situations when resources are limited. It may be better to be able to go on the fly because sometimes you have to go on the fly. Okay, so to test this, we looked at six-year-olds who are in this important transition between reactive and proactive control. So some, many will be proactive, but some are not so proactive. We gave them a delayed match to sample task with and without a distraction during the delay. And we assessed, this was an older study, even though it just came out relatively recently. So our proactive control measure was relatively coarse. So we just looked at their task switching across multiple rules where we think it's relatively difficult for them to reactively try to call up what they just did because there are so many rules that they're switching among. So we think it's a proxy measure of proactive control. And that was validated by looking at the kids' visible strategies on these tasks. So actually, I'm going to need to show a video. Will you start playing that back there? Okay, so I'll let you know when I'm ready. I'm not quite ready, but I will be in a second. So here's the task. Children are shown a stimulus, and they're told that they should remember that across a delay, and then three choices come up, and they need to respond with the one that they saw at the start. Okay, that's the delayed match to sample task. And this is showing a child on that task who switched in our proxy task switching measure of proactive control. So this is a child that we categorize as proactive. And these kids tended to show these proactive visible strategies during the delay period. And that's what this video will show, if you could start playing that. Can you start playing that in the back? Oh, great. Okay, so very prepared, very ready. And then if we can just start this video, this shows a perseverator on the same task. Okay, and that's about what our perseverators look like. They're not wildly off task. They're still engaged, but they're just not showing these visible signs of preparing during this delay period. And I don't know if you could quite make this out, but they would often do what this child seemed to do, where the stimuli show up, and it's not like they're thinking, oh, here's the one, and they go straight to it. They look and say, was it this one? No. Was it this one? No. Was it this one? Okay, yes, that's the one that it is. Very reactive. Okay, so what we find for these kids on this delayed match to sample task is similar to what I was showing you before, that they have this advantage. The switchers, who are the kids we're classifying as proactive, they're faster on this delayed match to sample task, especially at these long delays that really tap working memory demands. Okay, so again, this advantage where if you're ready, you're faster. The interesting thing is that if we now interfere with that proactive strategy, the advantage completely flips. So what we do here is we show a stimulus, then during this delay period, the subjects have to count backwards and tap their hand. So that interferes with their strategies to try to proactively maintain information across that delay. Now this shows that the perseverators are actually the faster ones across all of these delay periods, once you've interfered with this proactive ability. And so the idea is that, yes, proactive control can be good. You're prepared. Switchers are faster than perseverators on the delayed match to sample when they can be proactive, when there's no distraction. But reactive control may be more adaptive when resources are limited. So perseverators are faster than switchers on the delayed match to sample with distraction. And an intriguing interpretation, I think, is that this reactive control may become less effective as children make this developmental transition to engaging proactive control. So these kids who are more advanced in some way, they're doing better on the switching measure, they're more proactive, they're faster. Once you interfere with that, so they have to fall back on this earlier strategy, they're no longer as good at it. Okay? And so I think it's important to think about these kind of trade-offs. Proactive control is the mature thing, but do we want to necessarily rush that? It may have implications. And just as another example, people have shown that in the case of IQ, that prolonged development can lead ultimately to better outcomes. It's not necessarily that we want to rush. At both the neural levels and at the behavioral genetic levels, there's evidence that slower development is ultimately better. Okay, so inhibitory control is important in the moment and in the longer term, and so there's been all of this interest in intervening, and the work suggests that, yes, this is possible. But what I've tried to argue today is that the reason it's not been reliably successful with inhibitory control, to address that requires this refocusing, not just on the stopping process per se, but on this proactive monitoring that's critical for mature inhibitory control, and I think for developing inhibitory control as well. Much less is known about potential interventions for self-directed executive functioning, but our work is consistent with the idea that less structured time just in children's everyday environments may support that kind of development, but with many caveats and many questions remaining to be addressed, and we should always keep in mind these potential costs as well to improving executive function. I just want to end by thanking the current and recent graduate students, postdocs, undergraduate students in my lab for this work, given what I focus on today, especially Nick Chevalier, Chris Chatham, Jane Barker, and Andrei Semenov, who really spearheaded the projects that I talked about. Thank you, and thanks to my inspirations for wanting to understand and potentially improve inhibitory control in children.
Okay, thank you. I want to start by reminding us of an important social problem, the achievement gap. Lower levels of educational achievement are attained by children from families growing up in less advantageous circumstances compared to children growing up in more advantageous circumstances. Indeed, in the United States, children from the bottom 20th percentile of U.S. income score a full grade behind those in the top 20th percentile on measures of math and reading. And this achievement gap appears to be growing with age. So some recent data released show that the percentage of low-income students graduating from high school and from college is substantially lower and becoming even lower compared to relatively affluent children. Of course, the achievement gap is a very complex problem with multiple influences on it, what's sometimes called a wicked problem, rising income inequality, persistent racial discrimination, etc. But one proximal cause we've come to believe is that too many children, especially from disadvantaged backgrounds, are showing up to kindergarten without basic executive function skills in place. Executive function, as you know, refers to the neurocognitive processes that are involved in the top-down, goal-directed modulation of just about everything else that the brain does. These are processes that are related to intelligence, but have more to do with putting what you know into practice rather than simply knowing what to do in a particular situation. Usually, executive function these days is studied in terms of three cognitive attentional skills with specific neural correlates: cognitive flexibility, so shifting task sets or switching, for example, between perspectives on a particular situation or a set of stimuli; working memory, keeping information in mind so that you can use it in a top-down way to guide your responding; and inhibitory control, about which we've just heard, which refers to both inhibiting motor responses but also inhibiting attention, for example, to distractors. Executive function skills provide a foundation for learning and adaptation across a wide range of situations. So in a classroom environment, executive function skills are important for paying attention and avoiding distractions, important for remembering rules, for resisting impulsive responses, and generally for managing emotional reactions, including upregulating motivation and downregulating boredom and frustration. Children who've not acquired these skills by the time they enter kindergarten, which is a big increase in the demands on children's executive function skills, are much more likely, we believe, to be distracted, to fail to remember rules, to act out in class, and in general, to learn less effectively. There is evidence that children with higher levels of executive function actually learn more from a given amount of instruction. We've seen that in training children in the context of social perspective taking or theory of mind, and others have found that there are bigger gains, for example, in math achievement from the beginning of kindergarten to the end of kindergarten in those kids who have higher executive function skills, often controlling for intelligence more broadly. And so these kids who come to school, to kindergarten and the early school grades, without these basic foundational skills well honed, are more likely not only to learn less effectively, we believe, but also to end up getting in trouble. And the numbers of children, even as young as preschool-age children, who are suspended and expelled each year in the United States, at least, is disturbingly high. Of course, we've also heard lower executive function is associated with lower socioeconomic status. These are some data from Farah and her colleagues. But within those samples of disadvantaged children, there are big individual differences, of course, a point that Yuko made. And if you look at those children who are growing up in disadvantaged circumstances, who are at risk for problematic outcomes, those children who nonetheless do well, who might be classified as resilient, are those children who have good executive function skills, for whatever reason. Executive function measured in childhood predicts key developmental outcomes, predicts school readiness. Indeed, it does so better than IQ. If you ask teachers what are the most important things for kids to know before they enter your kindergarten classroom, they don't say the child has to have some rudimentary reading skills or, you know, understand some basic math concepts. Instead, they say children need to be able to sit still, pay attention, and follow rules. Executive function measured in childhood predicts longer-term outcomes too, predicts SAT scores, and then predicts a range of things even in middle age, including socioeconomic status, which ultimately depends to a large degree on educational achievement. So what can we do about this? Well, as we've heard, executive function skills are malleable. They can be trained. In general, of course, the brain's an inherently adaptive organ. It's always adapting to changing environments. In fact, we might say that our brain develops to a large extent as a function of experience interacting with the environment. We grow our brains in particular ways by using them in particular ways. And executive function skills, like any other skill, are modified through practice. This is true across the lifespan, but there may be periods of relative plasticity. So as seen with perceptual systems, for example, the visual system, sensitive periods generally occur when the relevant behaviors are changing most rapidly, when there are changes in performance that are occurring relatively rapidly, and this seems to imply that specific neural networks are adapting relatively rapidly to environmental demands. And there's evidence that executive function develops most rapidly during the preschool years, but also around the transition to adolescence. We've done some work recently in the context of the validation and norming for the National Institutes of Health Toolbox set of measures of executive function, which can be used across the lifespan from ages 3 to 85 years. And what we found is, indeed, very dramatic improvements in executive function performance in early childhood between about 3 and 6 years of age. But further relatively rapid improvements around the transition to adolescence, reaching a peak in young adulthood and then beginning a fairly precipitous decline during the latter years of life. Here's another figure showing the same data in a way that illustrates these changes in the slope of this developmental function. So this suggests to us that these periods, the preschool period in particular, may be a kind of window of opportunity, a period of relative malleability for the cultivation of these top-down skills, although clearly there's plasticity across the lifespan. But there are other reasons, too, to want to intervene early rather than later. It's easier to build good habits around attention and executive function if you first don't need to wean children off of bad habits around attention. A boost in executive function just prior to that transition to kindergarten could initiate a beneficial cascade of events. Children might find it easier to learn in that context. They may get into trouble less frequently. They may end up liking school more and being more motivated to succeed. There have been, as we've heard from Yuko's talk, a lot of efforts in recent years to intervene and to train executive function skills. A lot of these efforts have been focused on the preschool period. There are various curricula, Tools of the Mind, the PATHS program, and so forth. There also have been focal training studies, usually conducted in a laboratory. Students, children are brought in and given a series of exercises, often on a computer, and then outcomes are assessed. For the most part, these interventions engage children in motivated, goal-directed activity. That's especially important when trying to train executive function skills, since that's the context in which we recruit our executive function skills, when we're trying to accomplish something, and we're engaging effortfully to do so. They provide children with opportunities to practice executive function skills. So children are very much learning by doing. They practice paying attention, thinking flexibly, keeping information in mind. And a number of these studies also have the feature that they tend to cultivate the habit of pausing, even momentarily, stopping and thinking and putting things into context or perspective before diving in and responding in the way that seems most natural. Indeed, reflection has been a key part of our approach to understanding what executive function is and how it develops across childhood. And I'll just say a little bit about the iterative reprocessing model, which describes a dynamic interaction between more top-down influences on behavior and more bottom-up influences on that same behavior. And so here is a figure that illustrates some different levels of analysis within this model. We have goal-directed modulation of attention and behavior. That's essential for effective learning and problem solving. We can think about these EF skills as underlying that modulation and as reflection, and I'll say more about that in just a moment, the elaborative reprocessing of information, consideration of context. Metaphorically, you can describe that as stepping back, putting things in perspective before responding. This, we believe, is what makes possible the flexible reinterpretation of a stimulus, the ongoing maintenance of information in working memory, and the identification of an appropriate response that allows for the inhibition of an inappropriate response in that same situation. And then, in turn, we try to understand what's going on in the brain that makes reflection possible. And here we've described the reprocessing of information in a way that I'll say a little bit more about in the following slides. But first, let me give you an example, my favorite example, the dimensional change card sort. Children are shown target cards, and then on every test trial, they're given a test card and told to sort it either by shape or by color. It's a task-switching paradigm. It's challenging, effortful to switch between sorting by shape to sorting by color or vice versa. And in general, three-year-olds typically have a rough time with this. They tend to perseverate on this version of the task. They do so despite demonstrating knowledge of these post-switch rules. So you say we're playing the shape game now, right? And this child is continuing to perseverate and sort by color, and the child will say, right? And so you say, where do the, I don't know, cars go in the shape game or something? And they point to the right box, and you say, where does this car? And they turn around and sort it by color. A classic kind of executive function failure associated with damage to dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. In contrast, by about 4 years of age, most children on this version of the task switch flexibly. Like adults, they seem to understand that they know two different ways of approaching these stimuli, and they make a decision about which way to approach the stimuli before responding. In other words, they seem to stop, step back, and reflect on their own knowledge about these rules. And we've tried to describe the development of children's representation of this task using the following tree structure. So three-year-olds then who perseverate, who get stuck on a particular way of responding in this task, seem to be able to represent, to get their mind around a pair of rules like this one. If it's a car, it goes here. If it's a flower, it goes there. And then they're given a new set of rules. They're told to stop, not play the shape game anymore. Now we're going to play the color game, red here, blue there. They can get their minds around those rules too and represent them and answer questions on the basis of them. If it's red, it goes here. If it's blue, it goes there. What they seem to have difficulty doing is stepping back and considering these two pairs of rules in contradistinction so they can make a kind of higher order decision. Oh, I get it. If I'm playing the color game, then if it's a red flower, it goes over here. But if I'm playing the shape game, that same red flower goes over there. And in the absence of that kind of top-down, higher-order representation of the task, which particular pair of rules is most salient and comes to control behavior is determined in a more bottom-up fashion as a function of the dynamics of the task, for example, whichever rules have been activated most recently. Say a little bit more about reflective reprocessing. Instead of responding directly to the most salient aspects of a situation, those aspects that pop out in a relatively low-resolution characterization of that situation, what happens with reflection, we believe, is that that information is reprocessed and combined with other information about the context, about one's history in this situation, about one's future goals, and the like. And this information can then be described or labeled in the simplest case. And that label can then be, or that description, that proactive pair of rules can be used in working memory to guide responding effectively. Here's another figure that's intended to illustrate what's going on as a consequence of reflection. You have here a stimulus leads to a particular construal. There are interpretive processes involved yielding an experience of that stimulus. And with reflection, which unfolds over time, although you initially process the most salient aspects of that situation, more aspects of that situation or that stimulus can be brought out and integrated into one's representation of the situation as a result of this iterative reprocessing of information. And so with reflection, stimuli come to be construed relative to a larger context, yielding richer, more nuanced, more detailed experiences of a given stimulus. This is a flow chart. Don't worry about the details. That's just intended to show you that we've tried to work out what are the cognitive consequences for the complexity of the rules that children can formulate and use to guide their responding as a function of degrees of reflection upon a given stimulus. And each degree of reprocessing then allows for a more elaborate, complex representations of a stimulus relative to a larger set of contextual considerations as I described. We believe that this reflection is taking place in neural circuits that are included in prefrontal cortex and involve hierarchically arranged regions of prefrontal cortex with increasingly more reflective and more abstract information being represented in more anterior parts of prefrontal cortex in a way shown in this figure. And there is plenty of evidence that performance on this type of task, for example, the dimensional change card sort that I showed you, does indeed depend on prefrontal cortex. But of course, prefrontal cortex and the neural circuits in prefrontal cortex interact with other regions of the brain. And in particular, following Botvinnik and others, we've argued that conflict detection And the anterior cingulate cortex plays an important role in this whole process by detecting those situations where reflection is needed. And then reflection unfolds and allows for a more complex representation of the problem. It allows for proactive preparation in a given situation. So you have something like this, the recruitment of these networks in increasingly anterior parts of prefrontal cortex as a result of the detection of conflict. But then, of course, this is a dynamic interaction between these top-down and these bottom-up processes. Once a problem is understood, once a child, for example, says, oh, I get it, if we're playing the color game, this red car goes over here, then that will feed back and shut down that signal that says, we've got a problem here, we need to pay attention, we need to switch into a more effortful, reflective mode of responding. So, for example, our behavioral work with this paradigm, the dimensional change card sort, and other related tasks, has suggested that, indeed, those children who can describe the hierarchical structure of the task are those who switch flexibly. So the formulation and use of higher order rules, a lateral prefrontal cortical function, we believe, is indeed important. But considering the task from a more reflective standpoint does seem to interact with the detection of conflict. And some ERP work suggests that detection of conflict differentiates those children who do well in this type of task from those children who do poorly. So Stacy Espinay and others gave a group of 3.5-year-olds, some of whom might be expected to perseverate on this task, some of whom might not, a computerized version of the task, and recorded scalp electrical activity. In particular, we were interested in the N2 component of the ERP, a midline component that in children appears about 200 to more like 400 milliseconds in children following detection of a stimulus that requires some effortful discrimination. A stimulus that signals uncertainty or conflict or error and says, we got a problem, you got to switch off autopilot and take a more proactive and reflective approach to this particular situation. Source analyses from both children and adults suggest generators of this ERP component in the anterior cingulate cortex, also in right orbital frontal cortex. The amplitude of this ERP component generally decreases with age, and in some prior work we had found that these decreases are actually better associated with increases in executive function performance on independent assessments of executive function than they are with age. So we looked in this study at data from children who passed the pre-switch phase and then either failed and perseverated or switched and responded flexibly. And we looked at the N2 component on that post-switch phase. And what we found is that 3-year-olds who pass the dimensional change card sort, who switch flexibly, show a lower amplitude N2 component, just like older kids and kids in general who do better on measures of executive function. And we interpreted that in terms of the downregulation of this ACC-generated detection of the need for executive function and reflection in particular in those children who spontaneously detected the problem, engaged in reflection, and then in effect shut off that warning signal. In contrast to those kids who continued to perseverate and were detecting a problem, presumably, but didn't have any means to resolve that problem. And so that leads to a training study that I want to tell you about. This is the final set of studies that I'm going to describe, in which we sought to train children to stop and reflect and formulate higher order rules in the context of this paradigm, the dimensional change card sort. We, in 2013, published a paper in which there were 3 studies with preschool-age children. Children who failed the dimensional change card sort were assigned randomly either to receive reflection training or to, across studies, one of a number of different types of control condition. And then children were tested after training. They were tested before training and after training on the dimensional change card sort, as well as a number of other tests to begin to look at generalization of any improvements. And of course, we used an examiner who was uninformed of the training condition that children had been assigned to. In the reflection training condition, we tried to provide children with practice detecting the need for reflection, stopping, and engaging in some degree of elaborative reprocessing of the information. In particular, formulating a higher order rule for responding in this situation. So we might say to the child who makes a perseverative response, oops, when you saw the red one, you pressed the button with red on it. That means you were looking at the color. Now we're playing the shape game, the game with the boat and the rabbit. And we just talk them through in the context of this particular set of stimuli, and then subsequently tested them on a version of this task using different shapes and colors, also on different measures. Across three experiments, we found that children, all of whom to begin with had failed the dimensional change card sort, showed inflexibility, rigidity, following reflection training only and not any of the other kinds of training that we provided, children showed improvement on the dimensional change card sort. In general, about half of the children showed improvement, the other half didn't, and it's an interesting question what differentiates those two children. Children who showed improvement on the dimensional change card sort also showed improvement on a different task, a measure of false belief that required them flexibly to adopt the perspective of another person when it differed from their own perspective. So superficially a very different task, although arguably one that involves the same underlying skills, cognitive flexibility, and previous research had shown that performance on these measures is often correlated. In the third experiment in that series of studies, these were published in Developmental Cognitive Neuroscience, we assigned children to one of three different conditions. Reflection training, which they received one time on one day for a 20-minute period, or a minimal feedback training condition, same amount of time. In this, children were given the exact same experience with the same number of trials and the same trials, but instead of being given this elaborative feedback, they were simply told, that's correct, or no, that's not correct. In the mere practice condition, they performed this task the same number of trials, but they weren't given any feedback at all. And what we found is that only reflection training led to improvements in DCCS performance, and also led to reductions in the amplitude of this N2 ERP component. So trained children not only did better, but their neural responses now looked like those of older children. And here's a figure just comparing the ERPs for these various different conditions in that study. So even a brief intervention aimed at teaching children to reflect on the task and formulate higher order rules leads to improvement in performance on the dimensional change card sort. Improvements is also seen in flexible perspective taking. And in neural activity. We're now adapting this approach to classroom settings in which we've created a series of activities, for example, playing Simon Says or something like that, that are graded in difficulty. They begin with relatively many environmental supports, reminders and cues and that kinds of thing. And as children get better, those cues drop out, so they're doing it more independently. In the context of practicing those skills, we also provide that kind of reflection training where we're engaging these children in the process of elaborating their construal of a particular situation and indeed formulating proactive intentions or rules for responding in the future. We also engage parents in this process. Much of the work that we've been doing has been with disadvantaged children, including children who are homeless and highly mobile. And so we've figured it's absolutely essential that we include parents in this type of approach, since these children are going back into relatively chaotic and challenging environments. So I'll conclude by saying a key set of manipulations for improving executive function skills, at least in early childhood, may be those that foster the reflective reprocessing of information. Reflection is usefully viewed as a graded phenomenon. It's not either or. You can engage in more or less reflection. And each degree of reflection on our analysis has consequences for the complexity of children's subjective experiences of a particular situation, of a problem, for example, to be solved. And each degree of reflection correspondingly has implications for the complexity of the task-related rules that children are able to formulate and keep in mind and use in a top-down fashion to control their behavior. So we have this slogan here that reflection leads to increases in the complexity of children's action-oriented representations or rules, and that has implications for the flexibility and control of their behavior. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
My name is Eveline Crone, and I'm presenting a lot of work today that I did together with Sabine Peters. She's a graduate student, very talented, and I put her on the slide because most of the work that I present is from her. Okay, so I want to talk today about the development of performance monitoring, and I want to approach this from a neural perspective. So my research concerns brain development in relation to the development of executive control. And a lot of research on executive control development has focused on processes such as working memory and inhibition and task switching. And I want to make the case that performance monitoring is a key component in the development of executive functions, and it has not received a lot of attention. So when I talk about performance monitoring, I refer to the ability to monitor one's performance for the purpose of future performance adjustment. So for example, when you're doing a task and you're receiving feedback on whether you got the task correct or not, then processing this feedback is crucial to adjust your performance on the next occasion of that trial. So performance feedback is crucial for learning. And ERP studies have shown that when you process negative feedback, this results in a negative ERP component referred to as the feedback-related negativity. And source localization studies have localized this response in the anterior cingulate cortex. So ERP studies suggest a valence sensitivity in performance monitoring. Now, brain imaging studies, mostly in adults, have confirmed this role of anterior cingulate cortex, but has also shown involvement of the frontal parietal network. And this network is mostly sensitive to the informative value of the feedback. So the feedback does not necessarily have to be negative. It can also be positive feedback if it is informative for adjusting your behavior on the next trial. Now, in terms of developmental changes, when we study these changes in feedback processing, for example, processing negative feedback, signaling that responses need to be adjusted relative to positive feedback, signaling that performance should be continued as is, we see that if we make these kind of broad developmental groups, 8 to 11-year-olds, 14 to 15-year-olds, 18 to 24-year-olds, that there's an increase with age in the recruitment of the frontal parietal network. So this suggests kind of a general improvement in performance monitoring. But another study found that if we look specifically at activity in the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex after processing positive and negative feedback while controlling for the informative values, so making negative and positive feedback as important for performing the task, then we see that in adults there's increased activity in dorsolateral prefrontal cortex when processing negative feedback relative to positive feedback. But in puberty, stages of adolescence, so around the age of 11 to 13, there's not a clear distinction, whereas in these young children, 8 to 9-year-olds, there seems to be there is more activity in prefrontal cortex following positive feedback relative to negative feedback. So this suggested to us that there may be changes in how children process informative value of feedback when they are learning new tasks. Now, the approach we take to study these processes is brain imaging. You're probably all familiar with it. Here you see a picture of our Leiden lab, and there's a 10-year-old boy lying in the scanner. Through a mirror, he can look outside, and he can see the computer screen, and he has button boxes to give responses. Now, in this study, we follow children over longer periods of time, so we use longitudinal measures. And one of the approaches that we took is that we also asked approximately 12 children in interviews to describe to us how they learn. And this is just for illustrative purposes, but I want to show you this movie of these kids. So these are 12 different kids who explain to us how they learn new information. And they participated in the studies in Leiden, so they are Dutch, but it's subtitled. And I would like you to pay specifically attention to the individual differences in learning styles.
Nou, als ik het belangrijk vind, dan onthoud ik het goed en dan heb ik ook een goede inzet. Alleen bijvoorbeeld met iets wat niet zo heel belangrijk is, dan doe ik het wel goed, maar dan heb ik toch altijd mindere inzet, mindere indruk heeft het.
Soms, als het niet te moeilijk is, begin ik er gewoon een avond tevoren aan en dan stampen. Maar als het echt moeilijk is, dan doe ik gewoon elke avond bijvoorbeeld een aantal woordjes. En dat de volgende avond weer een aantal woordjes en die andere woordjes weer herhalen. En dat dan zo bijvoorbeeld 2-3 weken van tevoren. En dat op de avond tevoren gewoon alles nog even overkijken alsof het echt goed in zit. Dan weet je het meestal de volgende dag nog wel.
Nou, ik vind het wel fijn meestal om een uitleg te lezen. Want dan... Vaak staan er nog dingen in die je niet, waar je niet zelf achter kan komen. Maar bij sommige spelletjes, op de computer bijvoorbeeld, daar zit geen uitleg bij. Dus dan moet je het zelf een beetje uitzoeken. En dan vind ik het soms wel wat lastiger, want ik ben niet heel technisch.
Ja, ik heb heel erg de neiging om geen instructies te lezen. Dat vind ik heel... Ik weet niet, ik begrijp daar toch niks van. Dus ik ga altijd maar wat proberen. En na 3 keer of zo lukt het altijd wel na een tijdje. En dan, ja, hoe langer je het speelt, hoe meer trucjes je kent. En dan gaat het uiteindelijk gewoon zelf. Ja.
Bijvoorbeeld de hersens. Je denkt over iets na om iets te doen. En met een snelle reactie gaat het alleen via je hersenstam. Maar toch denk je erover na. Eigenlijk denk je over alles wel na. Denk ik. Denk weer over iets.
Van de ene gedachte komt weer een nieuwe gedachte.
Ja. Ja, allemaal wegen die je opent en uiteindelijk eindig je ergens. Maar het eindigt eigenlijk nooit.
Ja, dan denk ik gewoon na, want ja, ik denk er eigenlijk niet zoveel over na, hoe ik erover nadenk.
Nou, bijvoorbeeld op de Wii, dan heb ik iets nieuws. En dan heb ik geen idee hoe het gaat. Dan probeer ik het meestal gewoon. En dan kijk ik meestal ook naar de poppetjes en zo. En die vertellen me dan dingen. En dan weet ik ook wat ik moet doen.
Oké, okay. Hier kan ik mee lopen. Kan ik al lopen?
Ja. Je moet die met A die dingen pakken.
Waar loop je mee dan?
Waar pakken? Nou, met A kan ik springen.
Nee, die sterren.
Oké, kan ik daarna springen?
Nee.
Dat en nu? Nu loop ik gewoon aan de onderkant.
Ja, daar met A.
Waar?
Dit, dat moet je pakken.
Oké, okay. Maar dan moet ik toch springen?
Nee, je hoeft niet te springen.
Met A, ik druk op A.
Op A klikken, daarop. Ja, nu op A. A ingedrukt houden.
Ik vind het altijd een beetje irritant dat mijn vader en mijn moeder... die zijn altijd van, en wat moet ik nu doen? En wat moet ik nu doen? En dan denk ik altijd zo van... Waarom loop je eens niet naar dat poppetje en dan ga je eens met hem praten, kijken of je er meer te weten komt. Maar dat kunnen ze dan niet zelf verzinnen. En ik kan dat altijd heel snel zelf verzinnen. En dus meestal ga ik zo te werk met een nieuw spelletje.
Ja, zie je? Nou pak ik gewoon die dingen.
Maar dat moet niet.
Oké, So one of the things we've noticed in a lot of our research is that young children, they use a more explorative way of learning. They just try out things and then try to discover what the rules are, whereas adults usually use more a hypothesis testing way of reasoning. And the questions that we wanted to address in this research is, how does this feedback monitoring develop across childhood and adolescence? And what is the relation between neuroactivity, age, and performance or learning style? We also wanted to know what are the within and between person changes and differences. So that's why we wanted to follow the same individuals longitudinally. And finally, we wanted to know if it also had implications for example, educational outcomes. Okay, so I'm presenting data that are part of a larger study called Brain Time, and the Brain Time project is a big study where we're trying to understand cognitive and social affective development in relation to neural development and hormone levels. And it has a longitudinal design where there were 299 individuals at the first measurement and 255 2 years later. So I'm just showing you quickly the setup of the sample. So here you see age plotted horizontally. You see the number of males and females in each age group. And we tried to get approximately the same number of participants in each age group, but we oversampled around the ages of puberty to distinguish between puberty and age-related changes. So this is the first time point, and at the second time point, here you see the final data set, and you see that there are some dropouts, mostly because of braces. Okay. So when people came to the scanner, they first in the morning took samples of saliva and urine, and they brought it with them, and we put it in the fridge. Then when they went into the scanner, we first did a resting state scan. This is a scan where they don't have to do anything. They can just think about random things, but it allows us to look at which brain regions are synchronously activated, so which regions of the brain are activated at the same time, forming a network. And we can look at those network changes over time. Then they did two fMRI tasks. The first one was a learning task, and the second one was a reward friendship task. We took a DTI scan to look at white matter development, and a high-resolution structural scan to look at gray matter development. And today I want to talk specifically about the learning task, and I want to show you quickly also some results of the resting state task, where we try to relate the fMRI and the connectivity measures. Okay. When they came out of the scanner, there was also a behavioral session in which we got their IQ, working memory capacity, and reading and arithmetic as indices of educational outcomes. And then they did a couple of measures which were more related to the social affective part of the experiment, which was a balloon risk-taking task, a delay discounting task. We got in a DNA swab. The parents filled out the child behavior checklist and the brief, which is a questionnaire for executive functions. And then when the kids were at home, they completed a couple of self-report measures also, like the Big Five and those kind of measures. Okay, so what we wanted to know is we wanted to test specific patterns of brain development, behavioral and brain development. And one of our models was the linear predictor model, where we expected that across the whole range of adolescence, there would be a linear increase in behavior and neuroactivity. And we plotted and we tested that against the model of the more log linear development. So there will be a steep increase between ages of 8 to 12, like Phil showed in his slides, and then a relatively stable pattern after the age of 12 to 14. And the third model we tested was the quadratic model, where we looked for neuroactivity that was specific for mid-adolescence. So there will be stronger activity during mid-adolescence relative to childhood and adulthood. The task that we used was a learning task, and we thought about this task well before we started to implement it, because it has several different features that were interesting for our questions. So basically, it was very simple. What participants had to do is, here they see a picture of an animal, in this case an elephant, and they have to plot it in one of, they have to sort it in one of three boxes. So there are three animals, three boxes. The only thing they have to do is find out where each animal belongs. Now, they don't know beforehand, so in this case, for example, they might try the left button, and then they receive feedback. And in this case, it would be a minus feedback, so that would mean that the box that they chose was wrong, but it can also be a plus feedback, and in that case, the box that they chose was correct. So it goes on like that. It's a sorting task where they tried three different pictures and tried to sort it in three different boxes. So for example, the next trial might be a giraffe, and then they need to find out where the giraffe belongs, and this goes on and on and on until they have discovered the rules, and then they switch to a new set with new pictures. And the idea here was that we were interested in how fast they learned, but also how efficient they learned. And for example, here you see that the elephant was tried in the left butt, on the left location. Now, some of you have already reasoned that if you now want to find the correct location for the giraffe, it is best to sort it either on the middle or on the right. Or it's best to sort it on the left, because there you have a 50% of getting it right, whereas the middle one and the right one, you have a 33% of getting it right. So there are different levels of processing that you can do for this task. Some ways of learning are more trial and error, just trying out different things, and some way of processing are really higher level, where you try to think about all the different options and try to not make the mistake of making a less efficient response than necessary. Now, in terms of neuroactivity, we time-lock the neuroactivity to the moment of the feedback. And we're interested in learning from negative feedback, from positive feedback, relative to just applying the rule after you have already learned it. So we're going to be looking at the learning phase, which encompasses both positive and negative feedback, and the application phase, which only encompasses positive feedback, because this is when participants have learned. Okay, so if we look at behavior generally, here you see percentage correct during the task plotted for all the age groups. And we took 8 to 9-year-olds together to make the group as large as for the other ages. So what you see here is a relatively steep increase until approximately the age of 12 to 14, and then a relatively stable line of performance. Now, by looking into these learning strategies, and we used hidden Markov modeling together with Maartje Rijmakers from the University of Amsterdam, we were able to differentiate between different learning types. And these learning types could be people who have a low learning strategy, where they just try it out by a kind of trial and error. It can be a high learning strategy where they sort very efficiently, and it can be two types of medium sorting strategies where they make different types of suboptimal choices. And when we look at how these learning types are distributed across the different ages, what you see is that the low learning type is mostly present in the 8-year-olds, whereas the high learning type is mostly present in the adults. But even in, for example, 10-year-olds, there are some kids that already show a high learning profile. And even in the adults, there are some adults who try to solve the task with a low type of learning strategy. So this allowed us to distinguish between neuroactivity related to learning strategy and age. And if we're looking at neuroactivity for the learning phase relative to the application phase, we see that the high performance, so people with a high learning strategy, recruit the frontal parietal network more relative to individuals with the low learning strategy, and the medium learning strategy was in between. So this showed to us that this frontal parietal network is important for doing the task, and this activity is controlled for age. So even if, for example, you're only looking at a group of 11-year-olds, then we see that within the 11-year-olds, those are who are using the high learning strategy show more activity in the frontal parietal network relative to those who are showing the low strategy. The next question that we asked is, now that we know that this network is related to learning from feedback and it's more active for those people who learn better, is there also neuroactivity related to age change when we control for performance? And this was also the case. So if we're looking at learning from feedback relative to applying feedback and we control for performance, we still see age changes in a couple of these regions in the frontal parietal network. And we're trying to understand what this actually means. So it's not directly related to performance, but these are kind of general age patterns where we see increased recruitment over time in these regions. Here I'm zooming into one of these regions in prefrontal cortex to show you the general pattern of activity. And what you see here is three different bar types. The black bars are the learning from negative feedback. The gray bars are learning from positive feedback. And the white bars are the application phase. Now, if you look at the white bars, you see right away there's a flat line, no changes related to age. So there's no difference in recruitment if you're a child or an adult. But if you're looking at the learning feedback, negative feedback and positive feedback plotted in black and gray, you see that there's an age-related increase in recruitment of this region after learning from negative and positive feedback, and that age-related change is stronger for learning from negative feedback. When we saw the participants 2 years later, we selected regions of interest that were important at the first time point. And here you see those regions of interest. So again, we're looking at different regions in the frontal cortex on the bottom row and different regions in, for example, anterior cingulate cortex, superior parietal cortex, and the caudate. And the first question that we had is that if we're looking at these regions of interest, do they show stability over time? So if we get the ICC values for activity in these brain regions for our learning contrast, do we see stability over time? And we made use of Kichetti's indices of stability for these types of for this brain analysis. So if the values are lower than 0.4, then we say that the ICC value is poor. If the values are between 0.4 and 0.6, we see that say they are fair. If the values are between 0.6 and 0.75, they are good, and higher than 0.75 is excellent. And I'm showing you here the ICC values for the sample. So in the caudate, they were relatively poor to fair, whereas in all the other regions, they were fair to good. So the stability over time within an individual over 2 years is actually relatively high. So neuroactivity is really an individual marker. Next, we wanted to see what are the age-related changes. So if we're looking at changes in general performance on the task, then we see that when using mixed linear models, which allow us to test these different patterns of development, we see that the log linear model is the best fit. So there's a steep increase between approximately age 8 to 13, and then a relatively flat line looking at these performance changes. On the right side, I'm showing you this activity for superior parietal cortex. And even though it looks a bit messy, when we when we fit the model, there's actually a strong fit of the log linear model, again showing this relatively early rise and then a relatively flat line. Now you see right away that there's quite some variability in terms of performance and in terms of neuroactivity. Some people show an increase over time, some people show a decrease over time. So for example, here we see someone that doesn't change much, this is someone that shows a steep increase over time, and this is someone that shows a steep decrease over time. In terms of neuroactivity, you also see flat lines, increases and decreases. So we wondered, can we explain some of that variability by relating these to each other? In other words, are those people who improve in performance over time also the ones that show an increase in their activity over time? And are those individuals that show a decrease in performance over the time also the ones that show a decrease in their activity over time? And this was indeed the case. So here we're looking at a change in brain activity and a change in performance over time. And we see a nice correlation showing that individuals who show a negative change in learning also show a negative change in brain activity. And those who improve a lot in learning also show an increase in neuroactivity. So there's quite a strong relation between this neuroactivity and behavior. So we were happy with that. The next question we asked was, now that we know that this neuroactivity correlates very well with performance on the task, does it also correlate with other measures? For example, measures that are important for kids in school. So here we're looking at reading fluency at time point 2 and mathematics at time point 2. And on the y-axis, you see activity in these brain regions in prefrontal cortex at the first time point. So we're looking at brain activity at the first time point and seeing if it can predict reading at the second time point. And it does for both reading and for mathematics. And actually, if we use a regression model, we see that there's a unique contribution of dorsolateral prefrontal cortex activity at time point one, predicting fluency in arithmetic at time point two, when we control for age and performance at time point one. One of the questions that are often following these kind of types of presentations is, if you're looking at this specific neuroactivity in dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, is that a good way to go, or should we look at the larger network? And we wanted to address that question by taking the seed of the region in dorsolateral prefrontal cortex that showed the strongest age change and see how that seed region was connected to other regions of the brain. And here you see the picture of that seed. So here is the seed of the region in dorsolateral prefrontal cortex that showed a strong change in behavior. And here you see negative connectivity over time. And that means that when getting older, these regions get less connected. It's kind of interesting because these are regions in the motor cortex. So it seems that at an early age, dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and the motor cortex are very connected. And when growing older, they are less connected over time. In yellow, you see the regions that show an increase in connectivity over time. So in older individuals, this region in dorsolateral prefrontal cortex is more connected to, for example, these regions in the caudate. And the caudate is known to be important for learning from feedback as well. So this seems to increase with age. Now you may wonder, is this meaningful? And does this tell us something about how well they do on the task? Well, in fact, it does. Stronger connectivity between dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and the caudate correlated with better learning. Okay. So to conclude, my main conclusion based on this research, but also a lot of other research that has been going on in my lab in the last 10 years, is that the immaturity hypothesis, which many of us proposed approximately 10 years ago, including me. So this immaturity hypothesis stating that certain brain regions are not mature at a young age, or maybe are not recruited at a young age, seems to be a limited way of understanding the larger body of data. So the learning styles seem to change, and neuroactivity correlates with these changes in learning styles. But it's not necessarily the case that the region is not available to children at a young age. Together with Randall, I did a meta-analysis of cognitive control studies that were published until 2012. And we looked at whether there was a consistent pattern in increases in neuroactivity for dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. But it turned out that about half of the studies showed an increase over time, and the other half showed a decrease in neuroactivity in prefrontal cortex over time. But the conclusion sections of all the papers were the same, showing, well, there's development of prefrontal cortex, but the direction seems to be in opposite directions. So the data just don't support this idea of immaturity at an early age and maturity at a later age. Instead, it seems to be that the protracted development of prefrontal cortex, which is not only related to prefrontal cortex showing changes in recruitment, but also in gray matter and connectivity, this protracted development may also result in increased flexibility. Think of the young kid telling the parents, you should just try to solve the task by trying out things and not necessarily always in a hypothesis testing way. So this kind of increased flexibility may also have advantages which are probably important for this phase in life, for example, adaptation to different social contexts and cultures. And we try to summarize that in this figure. So if there's gradual development of these prefrontal cortex systems, then this may change, for example, the motivational and goal flexibilities of a certain individual over time. And we also know from a set of other studies that in mid-adolescence, there's this increase in sensitivity of brain regions that are important for processing all kinds of emotions, like sensation seeking and novelty seeking. And the kind of collaboration between these systems may, over time, in some individuals lead to negative trajectories, for example, adolescents who develop anxiety or depression. But in most adolescents, 80% of the adolescents, this increased flexibility of prefrontal cortex together with this influence of these affective systems will lead to positive growth trajectories, which will allow adolescents to show adaptive exploration and learning eventually to develop mature social goals. So I wanted to stop here. First, thank my lab for helping me with all these studies. And I specifically want to thank my collaborators, Sabine Peters, who did most of the research that I showed today, Barbara Braamse, Rosa Meeuwissen, Anna van Duiven for the Jiska paper, Bernard Gurelu and Kiki Zanoli. And I want to thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you, Terry. What Terry didn't say was that I'm not an expert in executive function at all. And I was very surprised to be asked to be the discussant here, and I've learnt a lot. And of course, when people send you their slides in advance, you have to guess what they're going to say, and often you've guessed wrong. So here we go. I'm going to make three comments. The first is a very short one, but I wanted to pay homage to Walter Michel. He was the co-chair of the steering committee, and I don't know if he was the first, but he's certainly one of the first I heard of who looked in children at inhibitory control. And this very famous marshmallow task that he's written a completely new book on in 2014, so I thought we should recognize his contribution to executive function. I want to do two other things. I want to first sort of mention briefly the things I've liked about these different talks and certainly learnt so much more today listening to them. And then I want to ask, where are we going from here? What are the other approaches that I might have liked to have heard embraced in the talks to this symposium? Okay, so first, very, very creative tasks. We've seen a lot of very different ones, and to adapt some of the tasks that we have for adults is really quite a challenge when you want to use them for children. I think Zelazo's task is a very nice example of how you can turn a task used for many years with adults, the Wisconsin, for instance, into a very child-friendly task. We've also seen a wide variety of methodologies, both behavioral and neural, ERP, fMRI, and so forth, and that's a really impressive aid to this. And we've seen, I was going to say a very wide age range, but I'm going to sort of counter that with a fairly wide age range, and you'll see why in a moment. What I also liked about all the work on the neural systems is that very often people take a rather static approach and try and identify a region. And many of the examples in the talks we've heard today are really dynamic, looking for network circuits that interact with one another and that are recruited for different aspects of executive function. The talks have shown that the greater the activation in these networks, prefrontal, parietal, and dorsal, anterior cingulate networks, the greater, we're stronger when there's interconnectivity, stronger between different regions, and Eveline's talk has given us some very nice examples of that. The greater the developmental age, but within that, there are differences between children who show clear advantages in problem solving and in monitoring their behavior versus those who are much lower, and they recruit these areas to a lesser degree. And also the better the performance. So children who are performing very well show greater recruitment of these areas. I very much liked Yuko Munakata's very counterintuitive conclusion that children who have less structured environments tend to do better on executive function tasks. And this is unexpected. But of course, when she says less, I don't think she means chaotic. Obviously, there has to be a balance between very rule-driven environments and the more more relaxed, more less structured environments that we see children in. I would have been more interested to see her develop more the difference between that and, although they're self-motivated, the use of gaming and tablets and so forth, because that seems to be a very different kind of self-motivation where we might find some interesting differences. This seemed to be a very different way of thinking than Phil Zelazo's sort of accent on the teaching of rules, the maintenance of rules in mind, and so forth. And I was thinking about things like Montessori, which is a very structured preschool environment. Maybe those are not the best environments for children to develop executive function. I also liked very much the stress of this developmental shift from reactive control to this proactive self-directed control. And I wonder what the relationship might be here with anticipation. So we know that children from a very young age, even infants, are able to make anticipatory saccades when in the looking systems. And what is the relationship between that and the kind of thing she's talking about in terms of proactive control? We didn't, unfortunately, hear Jutta Kray's talk, but she made a very nice difference in the slides that she sent me between the notion of process-based intervention, practice at sort of more basic level processes, versus strategy-based intervention, which is more verbalization and metacognitive control. And I'll come back to the issue of verbalization a little later. I also liked the sort of more general focus that was mentioned in several of the talks, that you think in terms of executive function, not just from a cognitive point of view for improving school outcomes and so forth, but also for effective motivational and so forth positions. It's going to be a very complicated story, and my message has always been we have to embrace complexity. We can't simplify things. Okay, so now some of the things that I would have liked to have seen discussed more. And the first is this lifespan approach. Why was there no infancy? I can't believe that we don't have the roots of many of the things that the different speakers address in infancy. So for those of you who work on adults and don't think we can test these kind of things in infants, I'll just give you three examples. They're very simple ones, and some of you may have even heard other symposia dealing with this. But we can train infants using gauge contingent eye movements. So the baby, do we have a thing? The baby will focus on one particular fish here with lots of distractors, and any time the baby's gaze moves away from that, the whole screen will freeze. And the baby gradually learns that his or her own control of eye movements will make the things move again. The same here, another task by Sam Vass and colleagues, where the baby's eye movements are contingent, the movement of the objects is contingent on the baby's eye movements. And again, the screen freezes any time the baby looks away. And one can include increasing number of distractors push the baby further and further into understanding the control. Another thing we do with babies is infant paired associate learning. So here are two screens that the baby sees. On one screen, there's a little, not sure what animal it is, a little animal, and a very jolly rhythm is played at the same time. This disappears, and on the other screen, there's a squirrel, I think it is, and a very slow lullaby. And the baby sees this several times, and then what the baby is shown is a blank screen, but one of the tunes playing. And we look to see whether the baby orients very rapidly to the correct position. So the baby has to map the auditory and the visual input. And what we can do is progressively increase the delay at which the baby will see the blank screen. So we can do it immediately just to make sure encoding has happened correctly. We can do it at the end of a long session, or we can even do it the next morning after sleep. And interestingly, first look, so that very first look that shows that the baby has made the mapping, the visual auditory mapping, is correlated with some of the sleep patterns, such as fragmentation. So babies who have highly fragmented sleep do not show as strong paired associate learning as those who don't. And I'm going to come back to sleep in a moment. The other thing we've looked at with colleagues at the University of East London is how early we can detect changes in the brain. And I've took this example particularly because it shows changes in the gamma band activity in prefrontal cortex. Now, everyone has mentioned prefrontal cortex in this symposium, and it this suggests that differences in socioeconomic status, something we heard a lot about yesterday, can be found in babies' brains as early as 6 months. And this suggests that the roots of some of the problems that are going to occur later in prefrontal cortex functioning may well be rooted in very, very early development. So this is a really big plea for add to this nice long thing which has run from about the age of 3 to 85, I think the oldest was, add infancy studies to this, because I think we need to find the roots of many of these things. The same with the brain, the gradual development of these circuits happen earlier than just at the age of 3 or 5 or whenever the researchers looked at that. Also, one of the things that is really very frequently found, I don't think I've ever found a genetic syndrome that didn't have problems with executive function. It seems to be something that is constantly seen that is impaired. And often studying neurodevelopmental disorders allows us to pull apart the different aspects that are impaired because they differ from one group to another. If you want to hear more about neurodevelopmental disorders, I promised my colleague Jamie Edgin that I would announce that they got the room wrong for our symposium tomorrow. It's here in this building, in the Kreuzsaal, which is just through there, and not in the other hotel. That's a plea for tomorrow. I wrote this down because of what I saw in the overheads, but actually Eveline Crone's talk made it very clear that she is focusing on individual differences and looking at the very fine differences that you see between behavior and neural activity. I think that psychology in general has neglected individual differences, and I think more is needed to really focus on that. I have a nice picture from Derek Moore just showing how these are children who are all developing typically, and their scanning patterns are so different from one to another. So we need really to take into account individual differences. We've talked about an integrative symposium, so I was surprised that there weren't measures of genetics. Again, Eveline has obviously taken these, she just didn't include them in the slides that she sent me, but it's quite clear that allelic differences will make intervention work in some cases and not in others, irrespective of all other factors. So there are really allelic differences that actually are determining whether or not the child will react to certain environmental training over others. Why no mention of sleep? I've mentioned it briefly just now. It's a topic that I feel is very important, and there have been a number of studies, Edgen is one of the people working on this, who've shown that sleep disruption, and we see this in many children, actually disrupts prefrontal cortex functioning. So measures of sleep could be a very important way of adding something to our understanding of why executive function develops well in some children and not in others. And we've done a lot of work on sleep recently, and it really is a factor that differentiates, again, shows individual differences that are important. On the topic of intervention, I was surprised, because as I said, I'm not in this field of work on executive function, how much people relied on verbal interventions, metacognitive interventions. But of course, metacognition isn't just verbal. So I'd like to just suggest one or two other factors. So first, drawing, maps, other external memory devices can serve as metacognitive devices for executive function. There are nice examples of things that children do spontaneously. If you set them up in a problem-solving situation, they will often, if they have a goal, but they have to leave the goal with a detour for the means, they'll often put their finger on the goal place while they're doing something else and then come back to it. So they're marking externally, and this is part, I think, of executive function, I think you would agree, in ways that are nonverbal, and that may be another way of using training. There's also a difference, and I don't know how to get at this exactly, but when a child is focused on a goal, they need to bring certain knowledge for that goal. If that same knowledge is needed as a means to the goal, they can access the knowledge more easily, and I'd like to see more studies of that. There's something about the representation of knowledge changes, whether it's the means to a goal or a goal itself, and I think we need to understand much more about that. There's also some nice studies by an English woman, I've forgotten her first, Gwyneth Doherty Sneddon, who's been looking at when you pose children, I think she's doing it with maths, but it could be with any situation, if you pose somebody a very hard question, they will look away. Because the social interaction, part of eye-to-eye, face-to-face interaction, is actually taking up neural resources that they need for the hard problem. So teaching, and she's been looking at, this is with developmental disorders, she's been looking at teaching children to look away from other distracting stimuli in order to solve a problem. And I think these are nice sort of nonverbal ways of thinking more broadly about how we go about monitoring our own behaviors. I want to end on very briefly on a theoretical issue, and I thought no one had addressed it, but Yuko, in the end of her talk, brought it in today. But it's a question of balance. And so why don't we have unbounded flexibility, unbounded plasticity? In evolutionary and ontogenetic terms, that wouldn't be a good idea. In fact, as Yuko actually pointed out too, there needs to be a balance between stability in a system and flexibility in a system. And getting that balance right is really part of the challenge of development, I believe. And there's some lovely work by Takao Hench talking about the reason why we just can't have unbounded plasticity in the brain. There have to be constraints alongside the plasticity. So I had a question which was similar to yours. Could executive control training be detrimental in any cases? And I think we need to ask that question. Might it be that we, instead of training executive control, we train automatization, freeing thereby the resources needed for executive control? Could it be that children who are having difficulty sometimes with executive control actually are having difficulty making part of their reasoning automatic to free the resources for others? So it's kind of turning the thing on its head and saying, could we go about it in a different way? Maybe people have already tried this. It's not my field, as I said. Finally, there was something that Eveline said today and in the slide she sent me, which I think is an incredibly important point for developmentalists. And that is that executive control actually requires a protracted period of development. It might not even take place without the process of development itself. And I think that's a very deep thought that I will leave you with. Thank you.
I wonder, have you thought about how sort of representations or the way information is encoded sort of inside the brain, if you will, might change as well, right? So there's really, I guess, kind of two issues. So one is sort of, what are the executive capacities used to guide attention, to navigate attention through internal spaces, for example, or external information. But the second is how those representations might be changing. So for example, I think in Zelazo's talk, you showed this change in executive control across the lifespan, especially into older age. And I wonder, in those cases, might it be that something about the way the information is being represented in the tasks, you know, in the working memory span tasks, is actually changing? How do you deconstruct or sort of disassociate the representational changes from the executive changes?
That's a very good question. And indeed, we have tried to map the representations that correspond with different degrees of cognitive flexibility, and also the representations that correspond with the recruitment of different networks within the brain. And so we have done a number of things to try to probe what are those representations, for example, that children have. One of the things I mentioned was just asking children to describe the problem. Children give spontaneously a characterization of some of these tasks that captures the hierarchical structure of the task, right? You've got two incompatible ways of responding to a situation depending on some cue. And those are the kids who tend to show cognitive flexibility. So we have tried to address that, at least in our work. And the prediction, therefore, would be that as, for example, cognitive flexibility declines with aging, that you're seeing changes in the degree to which adults spontaneously engage in that kind of reflective reprocessing that allows for the creation of a more complex representation to be used to then provide cognitive flexibility.
No, I think we have to switch to your...
Oh, okay. Now, yeah, that's on, right? Yeah. We've done some relevant work also looking at how abstract children's representations are across time, building on work that Phil and Sylvia Bunga and others have done to argue that, as you're saying, it's not just these executive processes that are changing across development, but the nature of the underlying representations. And one way in which those representations are changing is to become more abstract, more categorical, less tied to particular stimuli in the environment. So one hypothesis we tested is that kids who perseverate on Phil's dimensional change card sort are using these more stimulus-specific representations supported by more posterior cortical regions, whereas as you move forward in the brain and forward in prefrontal cortex, you're getting more abstract representations, dimensional representations about color versus shape as opposed to red and blue versus truck and flower. And the prediction we tested and found was supported is that for children who switch in Phil's task, they seem to be not just actively maintaining these new rules better, but they're actively maintaining more abstract rules in the sense that if they've switched to shape, say, and then you give them brand new shapes, they can generalize what they're doing to those new shapes. Their representation is broad enough. Whereas the kids who are perseverating, it's quite striking. They are sorting over and over again, you know, red things and blue things, even though you're telling them shape, shape, shape. But if you give them brand new colors, they fall apart. They don't continue to perseverate in that way, which we interpret as suggesting it's not just the executive processes, but the nature of their representations. They're much more tied to the specific stimuli the perseverators are.
I'd like you to comment on the differences between the Wisconsin card sorting, where you don't tell somebody a change of category, and your kind of task, Phil. I mean, it seems to me that a lot of people have tried similar tasks to the Wisconsin card sorting without telling children about the change of category and have had rather mixed results. So I'm not sure how analogous it is.
Yeah, so Annette noted the similarity, superficially at least, right, between the Wisconsin card sorting test and the dimensional change card sort. And indeed, the Wisconsin card sorting test was something of an inspiration, but it really is intended to be a different type of paradigm. Whereas the Wisconsin card sorting test is a learning paradigm that demands flexibility in learning, but also requires hypothesis generation, hypothesis testing, and the like. The dimensional change card sort is intended not to require that. Simply, it's a rule use paradigm as opposed to a rule learning paradigm, where they're provided with explicit instructions that either occur in the absence of interference or in the presence of interference, and the question is, can they follow those directions in the absence of in the presence of interference from past responses? So one way to think about that is, if you think about cognitive flexibility, working memory, inhibitory control, it's virtually impossible to come up with a measure that only assesses just one of those three things. They almost inevitably go together. But you can do something to minimize the demands on, say, working memory in a task like this by reminding them every trial exactly what they're supposed to be doing. So that's presumably not the primary source of variation in performance on that task.
We tried something that was much more analogous to the Wisconsin card sorting with 3 to 6 year olds in our early attention battery that we've designed. And interestingly, we got big individual differences right across the age group. So it's not as easy to normalize when you don't tell them the category that you're swapping to and remind them of those rules. But in a way, that's a valid test of flexibility and internal self-flexibility compared to your particular task. And surely that is also a part of executive function.
Definitely. It could be a more self-generated form of executive function like Yuko described.
This is a question for Yuko. Like Annette, I was very surprised by the correlation you showed between less structured time and executive functions. So we wonder what is going on during this less structured time. I wonder if you tried the correlation between not the less structured time, but the ratio between structured and less structured time and executive function. Because it seems to me that less structured time is useful if you have some structure guidance to know what to do with this less structured time in order to foster the executive function.
Okay, interesting. So we did look at the time that kids spent in more structured time also, and that actually, that relationship goes in the opposite direction. The more time that children have in structured activities, the worse their self-directed executive functioning on our measures. Again, I know that this seems strange at a certain level, and so I'm really glad that you flagged the strangeness and that you've raised this question, because I think we don't know from our findings how broadly this applies. This really was this very select, small sample. This bolder sample could very well be on one extreme. They may be, you know, relatively speaking, highly structured, too far structured, in which case protecting some more of that less structured time is associated with these benefits. But if you go too far the other way, which I think might be the more intuitive window, that can be chaos and there can be poor outcomes associated with that. And so our hope is to go and do this in a much broader, more diverse sample across different countries, cultures, and so on, to try to get a better handle on that. All we know is that for this group, that may not be fully representative, there is a danger of going to too much structure.
Just to further comment on that, it occurred to me too that it might be an inverted U-shaped function. The work we've been doing with homeless and highly mobile kids whose lives are not very structured suggests that may be one of the sources of their difficulty with executive function, having too little structure in their lives.
Is it working?
Yes.
On the same point, I found myself wondering if the structure issue was partially reflecting type of parenting. And that the parents that are really structuring everything are those that are over-controlling and intrusive a bit. And we find that intrusive parenting is related to lower effortful control, which overlaps with your executive functioning.
Right, yes. So we're interested in that question, as well as the question about how much the children themselves might be driving the relationship. So are there kids who are who are more self-directed and engage in control, and they then select activities where they have more room to engage that control to make choices, whereas other kids really gravitate towards situations more where that structure is provided for them. So the child can be driving part of the correlation in addition to the parent, and the environment can be shaping the child. So all those interpretations are consistent with this correlation that we found. We're going on to try to tease apart those possibilities with multiple directions. One is by looking at this longitudinal twin sample that's been collected at the Institute of Behavioral Genetics in Boulder. And they've tracked these twins over decades, and they have measures of the kids when they were 4, 7, 10, 11 on our self-directed measure of verbal fluency, as well as measures of intrusiveness of parents and other home variables. And so we're looking at that sample now, first to see whether we replicate this basic finding that less structure in the environment is associated with this better self-directed executive functioning. And if we do, we can then probe this large, rich data set to try to get a sense of to what extent that link is driven by genetic factors or driven by shared home environment factors and so on. So that's exactly the kind of direction we're going in now to try to tease apart those questions.
It'd be interesting, too, to get in your own work, maybe not in that data set, some idea of how much the child, as you said, picked the activities or was driving it versus the parent.
Right. Yes, yeah, we're following up with those families now, so, yeah.
Annette, do you want to?
Yes, I just, can you hear me? Yes, I just wanted to add something on that topic of parental style, if you like. We studied babies looking at parents who were more directive and those who were more sensitive. Neither is the best. It's all about balance. The ones who were very sensitive, their babies were good at discriminating speech sounds, finding out about the physical world because their parents let them do things and the mother was always adapting to the child. But the ones with the directive parents were much better at working out human goal-directed actions because they had to work out what their parents' goals were because they weren't being adaptive. So, you know, these things are all going to play a role in this complex developmental picture.
Sticking with this issue, if I may, Yuko, you were classifying directed time or structured activities being structured by the parents. But even when the kids are out with their peers or with their siblings without an adult in sight, there's still going to be dominance hierarchies there, which may impose quite a lot of structure. And I'm thinking particularly of the possible role of this in birth order effects, where an older sibling is pushing a younger sibling around, so to speak, in terms of the goals of their activities.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I think that just emphasizes how coarse our measures are, right? All we did was say, you know, tell us over this half hour what was happening, and then we did our best to say, well, here's this activity in general that is relatively less structured or in general relatively more structured, but we're not capturing, right, any of exactly this kind of richness that you're talking about. One might argue that yes, in a peer situation, there can be relatively more structure if you're being bossed around by an older child, but still there could be more room for negotiation and figuring out exactly how you take that submissive response relative to an adult who has really got you on task doing a very particular thing. But I agree with the overall point that these are coarse measures of just saying relatively less structured, relatively more. Another thing that we're planning to do in follow-up work is to try to get more detail. So it's not just here's this label for what happened, and then we categorize it. But one approach we're planning to take is to do experience sampling, where we're probing parents by iPhone periodically, several times each week, to say, you know, right now, describe in as much detail as possible what is happening. If the child is playing with others, what is that dynamic? What are they doing in that context? To try to get richer measures and see whether that gives us any different picture than these much coarser measures.
This seems to be a paradox coming out of today's talks. On the one hand, the importance of executive functions and how for future outcomes, and on the other hand, the potential disadvantages of training executive functions. And I'm wondering how you're thinking, how can we resolve this, and is individual differences, understanding individual differences, the way to resolve this paradox?
Can I say something about that? I think it's an important question. I'm glad that it's been raised. But I would suggest that we don't have very good evidence that there are negative consequences of training executive function, at least in the work that I've looked at. And the other thing is that it's an important distinction that Yuko drew between those kids who are at risk for problems with executive function and the sequelae of those problems, and training kids who are just fine. And it seems to me that the case is a lot stronger for intervening, you know, when you know that there's a risk for difficulties with executive function. But the other thing about training executive function, at least in the way that I've thought about it, is that the intention is not to to necessarily make kids more controlled, but to provide them with the opportunity to be controlled when needed. So to add some skills to their repertoire, not to mandate that they use them all the time. It's another important distinction, I think.
All right, maybe we'll get to end on time. Thank you very much for a great discussion.